أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. تسهيل يا سيدي. نواية الاعتكاف، نواية الأربعين، نواية الخلوة، نواية الرياضة، نواية العزلة، نواية السلوك بالله تعالى في هذا المسجد على نيته. قال يا مولانا الشيخ ناظم حقاً، يا مولانا الشيخ هشام قباني المدد للصحبة. Was given 5.5 years ago by Maulana Sheikh Hisham, and it is just an excerpt from a longer sohba, but an excerpt that answers the question of many people that comes back again and again. That saying, you know, how can we secure the doors of risk for ourselves, the risk that we need? And the answer, of course, is you cannot. You cannot. We cannot secure the doors of risk. It is not in our hands, and we will not. Only Allah secures the door of risk for us. So the title of this segment, Allah will open the doors. The doors, all the doors of goodness, Allah will open the doors. So the doors of rizq, leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The question should not be how can we secure the doors of rizq. The question is how can we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be thankful and to know what to thank for and when to thank for it. That knowledge, that is what we are qualified to get, to know. To be thankful servants and to be servants with open eyes, to recognize the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At that time when we recognize the gifts, all we can say is shukrullah, 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 to the end of our lives, and then alhamdulillah, 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 to the end of our life. And then astaghfirullah, 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 because we realize how much we have missed this. This is what Maulana is explaining, and he is trying so much to be gentle, to break it down for us the way that the mother bird breaks down the food for the little chick in the nest, so that it can process that food and digest it. Look how Maulana is going to explain it to us, that, you know, follow the medicine that we give you. Take it seriously and open your eyes, your heart will open, Allah will do that for you. And you will be flying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything will follow. Your rizq is already given, inshaAllah. Already maktub for you, written for you. So we start, inshaAllah. And there are subtitles which can be maybe more visible on your devices. But they are available here now, inshaAllah. And if there is any need, we will pause and explain a little bit, and then we will proceed.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Beliau akan menyampaikan suhbahnya pada sore hari ini dengan menggunakan suhbah dari Maulana Syekh Hisham, yakni suhbah 5.5 tahun yang lampau, yang bagian daripada suhbah yang cukup panjang sebenarnya. Temanya adalah bagaimana kita bisa mengamankan rezeki kita. Namun sebenarnya kita tidak pernah bisa mengamankan rezeki kita, karena yang bisa menjamin hanya Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah yang membuka pintu-pintu rezeki tersebut, dan Allah juga yang membuka pintu-pintu kebaikan. Lalu yang sebaik temanya adalah bagaimana kita menjadi hamba yang bersyukur. Menjadi abdan syakura, hamba yang bersyukur, adalah kita terus menerus untuk berkata syukrulillah, 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 atau alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. dan selanjutnya astagfirullah, astagfirullah, astagfirullah. Maulana Syekh Hisham mengajak kita untuk mengikuti obat daripada permasalahan kita. Lalu diingatkan pula bahwa rezekimu sudah tertulis oleh Allah Subhanahu wa taala. Mari kita sama-sama menyimak apa yang akan disampaikan oleh Maulana Syekh Hisham.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. نويت الأربعين نويت الاعتكاف نويت الخلوة نويت العزلة نويت الرياضة نويت السلوك لله تعالى العظيم في هذا المكان الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to all of us that everything in my hand I guide, I'm free. I misguide, I'm free. I do anything, I'm free. No one can complain. Because if we complain, we get worse. We'll be in trouble in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we complain, means we are complaining on what Allah has given us of rizq and day of promises. And rizq here means of spiritual rizq, of ma'rifah. So complaining is not in our best adab.
So number one, we must not complain. This complaint can be open, which is kufr. Yani to complain, to say Allah, as if to say Allah is wrong to make me poor. Allah is wrong to make me rich. Allah is wrong to give me this qada and qadar. That is kufr. But most of the time it is subtle. We complain in a subtle way. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala don't say to your parents, uff, like that. So that's disapproving of parents. Don't say that. That means also even more for Allah. That's why the awliya and the ulama, they have this issue that they say even the sick person must be careful, you know, like that. But they said the sick person is excused if they cannot control it. It is not a complaint. On the contrary, it is a kind of dua. So, but still, it shows you that you must be careful about the complaint. They come in different ways. They come in different ways. If, for example, we say, oh, you should have gone to this doctor, not that one. Oh, you should not have traveled on that day. Oh, like that. This is all from shaitan. So, you must be careful not to complain. That's number one. Number two, the fact that our result is part of the mithaq, yawm al-mithaq, the day of the covenant, alastu bi rabbi, qalu bala. So, on that day, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the covenant from all the souls of Bani Adam, and all of them they believed, all of them. But in different orders, some were first to believe, the first were the prophets, and messengers, and then the awliya, and then like that. And then the believers, the common believers, amen. And after that, even those that are unbelievers in dunya, at that time, they said yes, all of them, without exception. Very important point. And at that time, the rizq also was already decided for everyone. It's already decided, it's written. Does that mean we don't make dua for rizq? No, it does not mean we don't make dua or we don't work because it's written. No, that's not the ways of Anbiya. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, work, make dua, seek rizq and so forth, because Allah loves to make the avenue of our rizq from Him our work. He loves for us to make our work as if it is deserving of that result. This is only to give us additional rizq, additional thawab. So it is all from Allah. And last point in here, when we say we want rizq, most important rizq is what? Rizq in your ruh, in your heart, in your soul, in your nur. Rizq ma'nawi, rizq of akhirah, which is much, how much more important. It never ends. It is not like the rizq of dunya, which Allah gives to everything and everyone, even unintelligent or non-sentient or plants, animals, fish, microbes, everything, and believer, unbeliever, to everyone He gives that. And this is for a certain time, and after that it's finished. Next to infinity, how much is that? Even if we lived a million years, it would be zero. This is mathematics. Next to infinity, even the biggest number that you can imagine is zero. Not like zero, it's zero. Because infinity is, yani, so. Therefore, when you ask for rizq, keep that in mind. That's why Allah said, don't say Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanatan, period, finish. If those who ask for that, Allah will give them that and nothing else. Ask, dunya hasanatan, akhirati hasanatan. And what is the hasana of dunya? It is zikrullah. Even the hasana of dunya, it is connected to, as you will see now, Mawlana Shaykh, we focus on, not on expertise in business, not on getting degrees, school degrees, or getting the best job possible. All of that is nothing next to the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dunya. The zikr is what carries that. It is not the dunya which enables the zikr, it's the zikr which enables the dunya. Tamam? So we focus on that, and let us, mashallah, drink in these clarifications from Ahlul Ruh, Ahlul Haq, Ahlul Tariqah, Ahlul Mawlana Shaykh, and his family and his silsila. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us with them. Ameen. And grant us tawfiq and hifz through them in dunya and akhirah.
Yang bisa kita ambil dari apa yang sudah disampaikan oleh Maulana Syekh Hisham pada awalnya ini adalah, yang pertama, kita tidak boleh banyak mengeluh. Mengeluh akan membawa kita kepada kekufuran. Mengeluh itu bukan sesuatu yang dibenarkan, apalagi kita menyalah-nyalahkan Allah. Karena kita mengeluh kepada orang tua pun kita tidak boleh mengeluh, seperti dikatakan di dalam Al-Quran, kita tidak boleh mengatakan ah atau atau kita tidak boleh mengucapkan nada-nada yang tidak menyukai. Meski begitu, para aulia juga tidak suka melihat kalau kita sedang sakit itu mengeluh, walaupun sebagian membiarkan kita untuk mengeluh karena sedang sakit. Lalu dia mengingatkan kepada kita, atau kita mengeluh karena sesuatu terjadi pada suatu hari, oh seharusnya saya tidak berjalan atau tidak traveling pada saat itu. Tidak boleh kita menyalah-nyalahkan, mengeluh kepada hal seperti itu, tidak ada baiknya. Maka beliau mengingatkan kepada kita pada saat alastu birabbikum, pada saat itu bukankah aku adalah Tuhanmu. Dan juga ditetapkan pada saat itu tentang rezeki kita. Semuanya sudah tertulis. butuh kita semua. Namun ini bukan berarti kita tidak perlu bekerja, tidak perlu berdoa. Terus bekerja, terus berdoa kepada Allah. Bahkan Allah mencintai kita untuk melakukan pekerjaan. Dan kita mengetahui bahwa semua ini sumbernya dari Allah SWT. Rezeki yang paling utama adalah rezeki maknawi, rezeki akhirat yang terus-menerus mengalir. Kita ingat bahwa dunia ini beserta dengan seisinya dibandingkan dengan infinity atau keabadian adalah kosong. Kita tidak bisa membandingkannya, ini adalah zero, kosong. Maka kita ingat ketika kita berdoa Rabbana atina fid dunia hasanah, kita tidak berhenti pada kebaikan di dunia saja, namun sampai pada aqwa fil akhirati hasanah. Maka terus kita menerus kepada kebaikan juga di akhirat. Dan salah satu di antara rezeki-rezeki tersebut adalah zikir. Zikir ini justru bisa menarik dunia ini. Maka kita diajak untuk bersama-sama bersama dengan ahli ruh, dengan ahli haq, dengan ahli tariqah. Semoga kita bisa bersama-sama dengan mereka.
At-tariqatu kulluha adabun. Tariqah, the way or the way that we choose for ourselves, is the way of Mawlana Sheikh Nazim, may Allah bless his soul. That way is from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah directly. And we are very happy that we are from them. Al-Rizq yarzuku man yasha bighayri hisab. He will provide, he send rizq to anyone without account even. Allah, if he says to this whole world, kun means kun baban, a door for my rizq, then this whole dunya will be turned into rizq.
Complaining blocks ma'rifah in spiritual knowledge. That's one point. Second, we are followers of Mawlana Sheikh in Tariqah, and Tariqah is all about adab. So we focus on adab. See, adab means Sharia plus. Sharia plus. So if it is allowed and okay according to Sharia, Tariqah has a standard asking you to be, you know, more careful than that. Yeah. More careful. For example, I'll give you an example. The student of ilm, student of knowledge, must not allow themselves to neglect the sunnah. Whether in Salat, Qabliya, Ba'diya, or outside of Salat. So the Sunnah is closer to Fard for the student of knowledge. Don't forget the hadith of the Awliya, my servant keeps coming closer to me with what? With the Nafil. Nafil is very important. It's not just because it's not obligatory, so it's okay, no. On the contrary, it is your way to love from Allah. Until I love Him, keeps coming close to me, until I love Him or her through Nafil. So, this is our avenue. This is the understanding of the statement of the Shuyukh of Tahrir, for example, and the Ma'alawi, and the Al-Awliya. For us, Taraweeh is fard. That's the understanding. Because it's far not according to Sharia, it's far according to love from Allah comes through non-far acts, through sunnah acts. And Taraweeh is sunnah mu'akkada. So for them it's non-negotiable, and for al-sunnah wal-jama'ah it should be non-negotiable. And for Ahl al-Tariqah it is far. Tamam. So in that way, that is the way of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that is the way of Mawlana Sheikh Nazim.
Mengeluh itu akan membawa kita tertutup akan makrifah. Lalu ketika kita mengikuti jalannya Maulana, maka kita mengikuti bahwa dalam tarikah itu keseluruhannya adalah adab. At-tariqah kulluha adabun, kata Maulana. Maka dalam tarikah ini kita memaknainya dengan memahami syariah plus syariah yang lebih daripada itu. Tarikah memiliki makna bahwa kita lebih berhati-hati dalam kehidupan ini. Bahkan seorang santri tidak boleh mengabaikan sunnah nawafil. Inilah juga para salik yang menuntut jalan rohani ini bertarikah. Tentunya mereka menjadikan apa-apa yang sudah sunnah ini seperti nawafil menjadi wajib. Ataupun ketika kita sholat tarawih, bagi sebagian melihatnya hanya sunnah, namun bagi sebagian, bagi kita, kita benar-benar mengambil ini sebagai ibadah yang serius. Maka kita lakukan dengan sungguh-sungguh. Dan bagi kita semua, ini adalah bagian daripada ahlus sunnah wal jamaah. Maknanya sudah tidak ada tawar-menawar lagi.
And awliya Allah, they know that they have to ask for rizq for the ummah. That's why Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was telling sahaba, do your work, I do my work, because he knows if he opened the door of rizq, everyone will be happy, but everyone will forget his prayers, become so involved in dunya.
We don't complain, because if we complain, we will get worse. To complain is not a solution. It will not facilitate improvement. On the contrary, complaining is the way of getting worse, because complaining, the iman is going down instead of going up. It means we have failed the test. So we are almost starting from zero again, going backwards. We must not complain. And then the Sahaba al-Kiram, if they came to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is like an example of people coming to awliya and asking awliya to solve their problems quickly, with no effort, no need for sabr, and no need for fikr, reflection about my state and my relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want to take a shortcut, and we think that the wali will, you know, as if with a magic touch like that, a magic wand, solve everything, and then I can relax. So I am using my get out of jail free, for example, in a game, by treating the wali as my get out of jail free or bonus card or something, like a gift voucher. That's what we put down the level of the wali to, a gift voucher. Bravo. This is what you see in the wali, the supermarket gift voucher. Yeah, I wish you. Shame on us. Rather come to the wali saying, oh, in my heart I feel I don't have ikhlas. Can you help me with that? Yes, the wali can help with that. That is what they're sent for. That's why rahmatan lil alameen, you sit in their presence, they are a living zikr. Even in tariqah adab, when you are in the presence of Maulana Shaykh, you watch him. You do not busy yourself with something else. Watch him, and if he gives the okay, then okay, you can go to do your wazifa, zikr, reading your juz' of Quran, Hizb of Dalail al-Khairat, your tasbih and Allah Allah and salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or help in the kitchen, or help in the driving, or help in this. But when you are in his presence, you don't leave his presence unless there is permission or order. When you are in his presence and you watch him and you learn from the Shaykh, that is like the zikr of the zikr. It is the essence of it, the condensed form of it. So it is better than by yourself doing zikr. Because by yourself doing zikr, you know, there is chance that your nafs is there, that you are, there is no hudur. But with the Shaykh is watching your hal, your heart, like a hawk. You know the hawk, the eagle, like the eagle. You see, like the, so the murid must be, Mawlana Shaykh Nazim said, like the tiger watching the prey, or the cat watching the entrance of the mouse's house. Like that, must be watching every move of his Shaykh, so that he will not miss any teaching. And that teaching is from the heart to the heart. That's muraqaba. So he is saying that people come to the wali for dunya things, that is complaint. The wali will not respond to that. What the wali will say, we'll see what the Prophet said to the Sahaba kiram: you do your job, I do my job. Yani I know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if his qada and his qadar is running through the universe and creation, we do not interfere with that. We are servants of Allah. And the first servants, the prophets, will never interfere with that. They will always say, Ya Rabbi, what you decide, what you command, that is our wish, not to try to interfere with that. Same thing with the awliya. Even if Allah gives them permission, they can change everything. But they do not, because they follow what Allah wants. They do not act on their own. They are not free agents like us, trying to be free agents, trying to do everything that we like. It is as Allah likes. So this is what it means. You do your job, meaning yani keep within your limit and do what you have been told to do. What have you been told to do? He will explain in a minute. And basically your zikr, your wazifa, because that is a real act, that is action. It's not just words. If it's just words, it means we don't have yaqeen in our heart that this is real. So it is an action. You keep to your act, your program. I keep to my program. And you know, the awliya, they know their business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So each one in his sphere.
Kita tidak sepatutnya mengeluh. Jika kita terus-menerus mengeluh, bahkan akan semakin parah diri kita ini. Mengeluh membuat iman kita ini semakin turun, dan kita gagal dalam ujian dalam kehidupan kita ini. Maka dengan kegagalan-kegagalan tersebut, kita harus mengulang dari awal lagi. Para sahabat kiram, mereka selalu kembali kepada Rasulullah SAW. seperti juga hal-halnya dengan para pengikut para aulia, dia kembali lagi kepada aulia itu. Namun bagaimana sebagian orang menempatkan diri mereka di hadapan para aulia ini salah. Sepertinya mereka hanya menginginkan jalan pintas ketika berjumpa dengan para aulia. Mereka jadikan aulia ini seperti kita di supermarket, pengen dapat bonus, pengen dapat potongan, pengen dapat kemudahan-kemudahan. Tidak seperti itu bersama dengan para aulia ini. Kita tidak boleh merendahkan mereka. Kita harus duduk dengan seksama di hadapan mereka atau bersama dengan mereka, karena mereka pada dasarnya adalah leger yang hidup. Maka bersama mereka kita jangan mencari enaknya saja atau seenaknya bersama mereka ini. Memang pada waktu-waktu kita sendiri kita bisa melakukan wazifah kita, apa yang harus kita baca, membaca dalail dan lain sebagainya. Tetapi ketika engkau berada bersama mereka dengan para masyayikh ini, maka engkau duduk dengan seksama, perhatikan dirimu. Maulana Syekh Nadim juga memberikan nasihat, jika kita bersama dengan orang-orang soleh ini, dengan para aulia, maka kita ibaratnya itu berjaga terus-menerus seperti seekor harimau dengan buruannya, seekor kucing terhadap tikus. Kita terus dengan seksama berjaga-jaga, jangan sampai kita kehilangan kesempatan, karena pada setiap kesempatan bersama mereka ada ajaran, dan ajaran ini datangnya dari hati menuju kepada hati. Inilah yang dikatakan dengan muraqabah, terus memperhatikan hal itu. Maka diingatkan seperti dikatakan oleh Syekh Hisham, bahwa lakukan apa yang harus engkau lakukan dan aku melakukan apa yang harus aku lakukan, semuanya sudah ada ketentuannya. Maka apa yang sudah ditentukan lakukan, patuhi apa yang sudah diperintahkan. Mereka orang-orang yang lurus adalah orang-orang yang mengikuti apa yang sudah diperintahkan, bukan menjadi manusia yang melakukan seenaknya apa yang mereka ingin lakukan.
And an important point also is that if the wali gave what the person wants when they come to them to say, solve my money problems. Okay, if it solves it for them, in the end what happens? People forget their prayers. They will be so happy with dunya, they will be so involved in dunya, everything is rosy. In the end they will say, this is the best. Why akhirah? What is dunya next to akhirah? Illa mata'ul ghurur. It is nothing but an illusion next to akhirah. Next, if you compare the two, you will say it's like preferring the cheapest plastic instead of the purest gold. No one in their right mind would accept that. But we are vain. We think we know best for ourselves. But no, awliya, they know better. They know what is best for us. Believe that, because they have amana from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has amana from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the day of Alastu bi Rabbikum, already at that time, as Maulana Sheikh Nazim said in his book of Sohbas from Lebanon, and the teachings and the Sohbas now of his grandson, Maulana Sheikh Dr. Noor, just recently also. So already at that time, from the day of Alastu bi Rabbikum, all of the Ummah was already assigned in groups, each one to their wali. And there is amana and everything given to each according to their level of responsibility. And so the wali, they already know from that time who is their murid, who is their amana, who is their trust and responsibility. And they are not going to cancel that just because you come to them and say, now, I want it now, I want my solution now, I want my ease now, I want my jannah now, here in dunya. No, it's not going to happen. That's what he's saying. Don't you do your job, let me do my job. And I'm not going to make you happy in dunya if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, this dunya is just mata'ul ghurur, it is just a small enjoyment, and don't be deluded by it, don't be misled by it. That's not the real life. So we are not going to go against that. And that's what he means when he say he will not help you to build up your dunya in that sense. That's what Prophet ﷺ said, I'm not afraid of poverty for you. Because poverty is a reminder that this is not the real life here, but akhirah, so shoot for akhirah. Don't try to short-circuit the system to try to start your own program instead.
Jika wali memberikan apa yang telah diinginkan oleh seseorang yang mendatanginya, lalu apa yang terjadi setelah itu? Kebanyakan manusia setelah berjumpa dengan wali, lalu dia memohon untuk menginginkan sesuatu, ketika diberikan sesuatu yang dia inginkan itu, dia lupa sehingga dunia ini membuat mereka terlena. Syekh Jibril mengingatkan, apalah arti dunia ini dibandingkan dengan akhirat? Dunia ini mata'ul ghurur, adalah hanya tipuan belaka. Dunia ini ibaratnya seperti plastik yang sangat murah, yang tiada harganya. Namun dunia ini kita diingatkan terus bahwa ini tempat yang tidak layak. Maka pada hari alastu bi rabbikum, bukankah aku adalah Tuhanmu, kata Maulana Syekh Nazim pada subuhnya di Lebanon yang diceramahkan kembali oleh cucunya yakni Syekh Nur. Bagi pada setiap manusia sudah diberikan jatahnya, sehingga wali dengan murid sudah ditentukan siapa saja yang menjadi murid-muridnya. Maka Syekh mengingatkan kepada kita, aku tidak ingin kalian senang akan dunia ini, tertipu, padahal hanya mata'ul ghurur. Dunia ini bukan kenyataan daripada kehidupan yang sebenarnya. Maka Rasulullah SAW pun mengatakan, aku tidak takut akan kemiskinan bagi kalian. Namun yang dia takutkan akan kecintaan terhadap dunia ini.
And that is what concerns us. We think that there is only one dunya and that's it. So you need to take as much as you can from it and run. Allah wasakhara lakum ma fi as-samawati wa ma fi al-ardi jami'a. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making everything under your order, O human being. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ, He will made everything possible for you under your feet. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, whatever in heavens, whatever in earth. Means Allah opened to His servant those who are saying Tawheed, La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, are Muslims and believers. Allah will provide them not only dunya, but to provide them akhirah also.
MashaAllah. So, said, be careful of getting too involved in dunya. And then he said, people are acting as if this is the only dunya. People are acting as if this is the only dunya. So, since this is what we know, okay, now imagine there is another dunya. Let's call it another dunya also. But this other dunya, infinite good, perfect good. How can you compare this dunya to that dunya? So if it helps for you to understand akhirah, think of it as another dunya coming, just like this dunya came after the first dunya in the belly of our mothers. Who does not prefer to come out from the belly of their mother? They want to stay there more than 9 months and then stay there for years, it will not be enough. You want more. So the same thing here. If we live here forever, still it will not be enough. It will not be the same. It will not be complete, because this world is full of, the goodness is partial, and then it comes to an end. It's imperfect. It's disappointing. It's surrounded with suffering and issues and problems. So there is something else coming. Focus on that saying. So don't think this is the only dunya, in the sense that there is another life waiting for you. And then he quotes the verse, وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِنْهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has subjected and put under your feet everything that is not only on in the earth, but in the heavens. And in the heavens and on earth, for you, there is so much in that verse. All of it, Allah emphasized, all of it, without exception, Allahu Akbar. You mean even the angels? Yes. Because look how many angels He put at the service of human beings, which we do not know, but Subhanallah. So, the protecting angels, the recording angels, and there are some recording angels also that are only in charge of recording what salawat that we make. Yes. One of the recording angels, other than the two recording angels of the good deeds and the bad deeds, that is only in charge of recording your salawat. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad wa sallim. So he is saying, especially if you are following Tawheed, meaning every person who says La ilaha illallah Muhammad wa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam under the sky. Forget mazhab, different sect, this, that, don't think of that anymore. You say that, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. You enter into that gift that Allah subjects everything to you. And Subhanallah is saying, not only dunya but akhira also at your service. Allahu Akbar. And this is the khilafa of a human being, and the secrets of khilafa is a sea without shore. A sea without shore, and you cannot reach the end of its depth of that sea. Don't you shake at this speech? Don't you feel that if we focus only on the small problem of dunya, which is going to end in a few, we don't know how much time we have left, but our breaths are counted. In comparison to that, that sea without shore and that sea without bottom, is there any comparison between the two? It's like comparing, like we said, a finite number to infinity. It's like, imagine if you can look at the atom up close, the atom up close, and the molecule, you really use a magnifying glass and you see it as something huge, and then you zoom out until you reach the outer limits of the cosmos, of the visible universe, because there is also an invisible universe, and this is all created. Hey, where is that original atom or molecule left? It has been invisible for a long time as you were zooming out, right? And if you keep zooming out, even after the hugest constellations and galaxies that you can imagine, that they don't even have names anymore, they only have numbers, and still you keep zooming out to the, then they will also become as small as that. In other words, it is all zero. We don't focus on that. We focus on Allahu Akbar. And inshaAllah, Allah is preparing us to have hearts that see that. Because right now we cannot see it. Right now we look at the sun for a few seconds too long, we cannot, we'll be destroyed. Well, the eye, it's not good for us. So we prepare ourselves. How? You see, zikr. It's all about zikr.
Syekh Ibnu mengingatkan kepada kita untuk berhati-hati dengan tenggelam kepada hal duniawi ini. Dunia ini bukanlah sesuatu yang luar biasa. Karena sebagian orang hanya memahami bahwa hanya ada satu dunia, apa yang kita rasakan pada saat ini. Sedangkan sebenarnya ada dunia-dunia lain yang kita tidak mengetahui. Dunia pun ini begitu kecil dibandingkan dengan yang tak terbatas. Seperti ketika kita dalam perut ibu kita, pada saat itu kita hanya terbatas beberapa saat, yakni 9 bulan. Lalu kita lahir, lalu kita berkehidupan di dunia ini. Ingat, pada saat kita di perut ibu kita itu terbatas, lalu kita kehidup keluar untuk yang lebih panjang lagi. Begitu juga dengan kehidupan ini. Dunia ini memang penuh dengan masalah, tapi jangan pikirkan hanya satu dunia yang kita hadapi, bahwa ada dunia lain yang menunggu kehadiran kita. Allah mengaruniakan kepada kita begitu banyak hal, begitu banyak hadiah-hadiah daripada Allah. Allah akan memberikan kepada kita kesemuaannya. Allah memberikan contohnya malaikat-malaikat yang bersama dengan kita. Ada malaikat yang mencatat amal-amal kita. Ada malaikat yang mencatat salawat yang kita lakukan. Ada malaikat yang melindungi diri kita. Begitu banyak para malaikat yang menyertai kita. Dan ini adalah karunia daripada Allah. Apalagi bagi mereka orang-orang yang bertauhid, yang mengatakan La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Maka ketika Anda sudah bertauhid, Anda memasuki suatu ruangan yang begitu besar, yang penuh dengan karunia daripada Allah. Inilah yang dikatakan lautan yang tiada bertepi. Maka jangan kau bandingkan satu titik yang tiada artinya melawan daripada lautan yang tiada bertepi. Itulah karunia Allah. Maka dengan itu semua, janganlah kalian mudah untuk mengeluh. Janganlah mudah untuk mengeluh. Beliau mengingatkan kita, memberikan ilustrasi bagaimana betapa kecilnya atom itu, lalu dilawan dengan bentuk-bentuk yang begitu besar-besar, semakin besar. Tiada artinya itu semua. Maka kita tidak melihat apa karuniakan Allah yang begitu besar itu. Namun ini semua kita persiapkan diri kita. Persiapkan diri kita dengan berzikir kepada Allah. Semuanya berbicara tentang zikir kepada Allah.
So we are meeting here today to remind ourselves that not to complain, but to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever He wants from me, I'm doing. Allah will open the doors to those who has no doors to open.
So Mawlana said, there is a process, we follow the process, and we come together in such gatherings as there on that day to remind one another not to complain and to keep ourselves in that process, which is to keep our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, awliya Allah. And Allah is already responding and opening the doors for those who don't have open doors, who feel that there is a block. Allah is saying to them, keep in the way, I am doing what you are asking already. You may not see it yet, but it is done. Yani keep trust, tawakkal ala Allah, and have trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a sign of belief, actually. It is a verse of so many verses of the Quran that يعني المتوكلون و إنما المؤمنون الذين ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم وإذا تليت عليهم آيات زادتهم إيمانا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. the real believers at the end of that, hearing the ayahs of Allah, the reminders from His book, from His Prophet, from His awliya, the signs of Allah, your heart shakes and trembles. That is first sign of iman. Allahu Akbar. Amanna wa saddaqna. Haqq, true. I surrender to that. Amantu billah. I believe in Allah. I accept. Amanna wa saddaqna. Wajilat qulubuhum. When Allah is mentioned, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا, and when the signs of Quran are recited to them, they increase in belief. They have more belief than before. Their belief is stronger. وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ, and they trust in Allah. They depend on Allah. You say, وَأُفَوِّضُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ, تَوَكَّلْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ. Allah Kareem. Allah is all generous. That solution is coming. No problem. Tamam.
Maulana berkata bahwa semua itu ada prosesnya. Proses kita bersama-sama dengan Allah, bersama dengan Rasulullah, bersama dengan para awliya Allah. Anda tidak melihat, namun ini semua harus dikerjakan. Maka milikilah tawakal kepada Allah. Rasa berserah diri kepada Allah, percayakan semuanya kepada Allah. Seorang mukmin yang benar-benar mukmin, yang nyata, dia akan mendengar ayat-ayat Allah, lalu hatinya bergetar ketika mendengar itu. Itulah tanda sebenar-benar keimanan yang hak, yang benar. Maka aku berserah, aku beriman, dan kuakui bahwa ini adalah benar. Wazilat qulubuhum, dan bergetarlah hatinya. Ini kesaksian yang benar, dan kepada Allah lah aku berserah diri. Wa ufawwidu amri ila Allah, dan kuserahkan semua urusanku kepada Allah.
Keep only that relationship between yourself and his and awliya Allah, and from awliya Allah to prophet, from prophet to Allah, to the divine presence. Allah huwa al-Razzaq. Allah is the one that provide. If we are going to say to someone, provide us with, look how much it is very delicate. Although Allah forgives us, because we make sins, we make mistakes. If you say that today I brought 1 pound of rice, and by my work, because I worked hard, I got this rice. That is shirk. If we want to go into deep into the meaning, means you are putting yourself with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
This is an important point, that it is Allah's qada and qadar. It is not our qada and qadar. Allah yuqaddiru al-arzaq. He makes qadar of our rizq. If we say, I am in charge of my rizq, that is shirk. You hear sometimes professors, they say, man is in charge of his history. That is shirk. Without doubt. It's as if saying, فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدْ, that is a human being. This attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not human beings. The aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah is, you cannot even lift one finger without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, qada' and qadar. And even to say, it is not fire that burns, it is not water that stops thirst, it is Allah's act that does these results. But by ada custom, yani natural custom that Allah created, they go together like that. That fire burns, water quenches thirst, rice, bread, food ends hunger. But it is all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing. So same thing with that. It is not our working, finding a job or working, etc., and then get a salary. Then we got that rizq. Say we are, oh look, I can bring my own rizq. No. So be careful. When we use the term provider, we use it metaphorically when it relates to creatures. Because the only provider is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Razzaq. Dhul Quwwati al-Matin. He alone. That's what he's saying. It is a delicate point, and we are falling into that mistake. Everyone, right and left, alim, not alim, Muslim, non-Muslim, always making the same mistake. So may Allah forgive us. Ameen. We give thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Syukrulillah.
Ini adalah hal yang sangat penting untuk dipahami. Allah Yaghadir Arzak, Allah yang telah menentukan rezeki kepada kita, kepada manusia. Namun kita memahaminya dengan manusia menentukan segala-galanya. Seperti seorang profesor di universitas yang mengatakan bahwa manusialah yang membuat sejarah itu. Namun sebenarnya tidak seperti itu, itu tidak benar. Kita tidak mengatakan bahwa api itu membakar atau air itu yang menyetop haus kita. Tidak. Kita mengatakan bahwa Allah yang melakukan itu semua. Ini semua karena Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maka kita tidak berpikir kalau kita bekerja kita mendapatkan rezeki. Bukan begitu. Kita bekerja berusaha, Allah yang menentukan itu semua. Dialah Ar-Razzaq. Dialah yang sang maha pemberi rezeki kepada kita semua. Kadang kita salah memahaminya. Saya juga bisa salah memahaminya. Kita semua bisa salah memahami tentang hal ini semua. Maka kita mohon ampun kepada Allah.
So, we have to be very careful on how we direct ourselves in order that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us. That's why he gave us something very simple, very easy. He made everything within two words. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, kalimatan khafifatan 'ala al-lisan, thaqilatan fi al-mizan. Two words. He didn't say more. It's very light on the tongue, but very heavy on the scale. Means the way that Allah wants us to be forgiven is through these two words, because it shows His mercy, and Allah is the merciful. No one is merciful except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and from His mercy He addressed it to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed it to Awliya Allah, and Awliya Allah addressed it to the Ummah. So we have to be very careful on how we address our prayers and our relationship with everyone else.
Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. That hadith, the great hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about two easy phrases, yani words meaning phrases, that we say, they are very easy and light on the tongue, easy to say, but in the balance of deeds they are heavy, as big hasanat, and they are heavy as door openers, keys, spiritual keys for big progress, spiritual progress. Because if you say subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim, We are glorifying Allah, and at the same time we are giving thanks to Allah, at the same time we are making istighfar to Allah. This takes care of our mistakes. It erases them. It raises our level, and it increases our amal of hasanat in our records of deeds, which is what we need in dunya and akhirah. So it says this is like a solution for us to fix everything and to fix also our relationship with Allah, with Rasulullah and with awliya Allah and with the rest of creation. That you, in other words, we put ourselves in the right place of in the scheme of creation. We are a servant who is thankful, who is practicing Tawheed really, and who is asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take charge of their affairs really, haqiqatan, without shirk, without hidden shirk. And we are waiting and expecting the door of goodness leading straight to Allah's presence, straight to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam shafa'a, straight to yani the tawfiq and hifz of awliya to be with them at that time, all coming, kissing feet of Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his hand, saying, Ya Rasulullah, we are the ones that you called us your beloved ones. That is us coming to you, and he will say, yes, this is true. And give us that stamp of approval and granting, come now and bring us to the Divine Presence of Allah. Isn't that the biggest prize? Isn't that the biggest visit? Yes, it is. We're saying, keep that perspective, keep that relationship correct and strong and firm at all of these levels. Our, the one that we worship, the one whose shafa'ah we seek, the one who we seek as our shafa'ah to Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I mean the awliya, and then the rest of creation, and be careful. Be careful about with Allah's creation. That He created for what? For the same as Alastu bi Rabbikum qalu bala. For them to say, yes, you are our Lord. For that recognition He created them, not for us to come and judge instead of Rabbul Alameen. We don't judge. That is not our job. And that's not our position to complain. So look, these are the real doors of rizq. Have we heard any such teaching from, except from our masters? You see the difference between alim and alim? There is alim zahir, there is alim batin. There is alim of ahkam al-sharia, and there is alim of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Imam Ghazali said, there are difference between that, this and that. When you have a alim of Allah speaking about the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's different from the way of practicing the rules and regulations of the Sharia. These rules and regulations, they are practical in dunya. But the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a different matter. That is what they are saying. Imam Ghazali and the awliya Allah and our teachers, that is what they mean when they say, pay attention, stay with your wali, stay with your murshid shaykh, and Allah, have trust in Allah and keep in that process, inshallah you will have the rizq of dunya and akhirah. And it will happen when you turn back, you will not remember anything else except what you are now enjoying. And that is forever. May Allah grant us that. Ameen.
Subhanallah wa bihamdi, subhanallah al-azim. Ini adalah dua kalimat yang sangat ringan di lisan kita untuk diucapkan, namun berat pada timbangannya, bahkan sangat berat timbangannya. Ini adalah kunci bagi pembuka-pembuka, bahwa untuk meningkatkan rohani kita, kita mendapatkan dari hal ini, kita berterima kasih dan bersamaan juga kita beristighfar kepada Allah Subhanahu wa taala. Ini kalimat ini bisa menjadi solusi bagi hubungan kita dengan Allah Subhanahu wa taala, dengan permasalahan yang kita hadapi dengan Rasulullah, dengan para aulia Allah juga. Dan dengan ini kita menghormati pintu-pintu kepada kebaikan yang telah ditetapkan, juga seperti kepada para aulia akan kedatangan mereka kepada kita. Maka kita jaga perspektif ini dengan benar terhadap semua yang sudah dikatakan, dan juga pada tingkatan-tingkatannya. Dan kita juga berhati-hati dengan ciptaan Allah. Kita tidak boleh menghakimi segala sesuatu seenaknya aja. Kita tidak boleh mengeluh di hadapan Allah. Ini adalah ajaran daripada guru-guru kita. Tentunya berbeda antara seorang alim dengan alim yang lain. Hanya memfokuskan dirinya pada hukum-hukum dunia aja, hukum-hukum ini. Namun tidak kepada mereka yang membawa kita untuk mengenal kepada Allah Subhanahu wa taala. Begitu juga maka terhadap para wali, maka kita harus bersama-sama dengan mereka. Terhadap para mursyid, kita bersama dengan mereka pula. Semoga Allah mengaruniakan kita untuk bersama dengan mereka.
So the summary of these two words or phrases is mercy. Allah wants to give us mercy through those two phrases. So practice them and you will get mercy. That mercy Allah dressed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with it, rahmatan lil alamin. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dressed it on the awliya, and the awliya dressed the ummah with it. From the day of alastu bi rabbikum, that tartib, that organization, let's say, or order of creation, from that time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took care of it, took care of us with it. Look, it's already been there always for us. So what is our job then? To keep to our zikr, to keep to our awrad. Says there is so much to say, but people will follow or they might not follow. What to say except if you are one who entered into tariqah and you took bay'ah, keep to your will, keep to your awrad, your wazifa, your zikr, your jama'ah with good hope, husn al-zan, and mujahada in that way, without despair or sadness or worry. And if there are problems, they come and they go. Inshallah, just keep steadfast. That is sabr. Steadfast, strength, fortitude, patience, and faithfulness. Yani your contract that you made with your covenant, keep that. Don't switch like a bird from one branch to another whenever you think there is a strong wind. Now you switch to some other program. No. But keep faithful and inshallah you will reach success in the end.
Di antara dua kalimat ini ada rahmat, yakni kasih sayang daripada Allah SWT. Dengan itu Rasulullah SAW mengenakan pakaian rahmat. Begitu juga para aulia Allah dikenakan pakaian rahmat oleh Rasulullah SAW. Lalu apakah yang menjadi tugas bagi kita semua? Tugas bagi kita adalah terus-menerus untuk berzikir kepada Allah. Terus-menerus berzikir kepada Allah. Setelah Anda berbaiat, apa yang harus dilakukan? Jaga zikir kalian, jaga persahabatan dengan jemaah, dan terus berjuang dalam kehidupan ini. Tidaklah kalian berputus asa dan tidaklah kalian mengeluh. Terus-menerus berjalan istiqomah, lurus, dan jaga itu semua. Jangan bagaikan burung yang pindah dari satu dahan ke dahan yang lainnya. Semoga kalian dikaruniakan sukses di akhirnya.
I'm not going to say more because whatever we say, people might do with it and people might not do with it. So it is better to keep to yourself, to your awrad, to your prayers, to your family, and to your sheikh, of course, in order that they will open for us the doors that they are closed. Too many doors. There is 99 doors. For every beautiful name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a door. For rizq, there is a door. وَيَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. He will provide anyone without account. People are happy to, at the end of the day, they count the money in their stores, what they have sold, how much they have sold. But they never remember to count what they have done of goodness and what we have done of khair and what we have done of barakah, what we have done of mercy, what we have forgiven, how many people we forgiven this day. So all this comes open from Bab al-Rizq. Because you do good, you get good. You get good rizq. If you don't get it now, you will get it later.
MashaAllah, people are happy, Maulana said, to count their money, but they forget to count the rizq of Akhirah, which is the wealth that they will find in Barzakh. You see, the money they find here, we find in dunya. But what will we find in Qubur? We will find the hasanat. If not, then the sayyi'at. Wal'ayyadu billah. The sayyi'at will come in a not a nice way. It will be horrible. But the hasanat will be like something much more pleasing to see than all of the gold of this dunya. See whom? What is this, the believer will say? This is all for me, yeah? These are your good deeds. Allahu Akbar. The most beautiful living form even, in the form of a living being even. Say, so beautiful to see and such good company, this, I am your hasanat. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. So, say, count, instead of just counting your rizq as if this is the real foundation of happiness, count how many good deeds Allah gave you this day, how many people you forgave, how many sins you avoided, how many yani sadaqah you have made, how many sunnahs, nawafil, and acts of mercy, act of charity, act of ibadah, nawafil, and all of the things that can fill up your record of good deeds in Akhirah, because all of this is min al-baqiyat al-salihat. From saying subhanallah, alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, to a smile in the face of your brother. All of that, we'll see it again in Akhirah. That is the real account, the real wealth, the real treasure that you are building. Not the thing that comes and goes. So, plant your trees. Every subhanallah, every alhamdulillah, that is a tree in paradise. What they are saying, people must focus on the real rizq. This whole suhbah is about the real rizq and the role of everyone in that, all of the hierarchies of human beings, and then the creator, and the role of qada and qadar in it, and Islam to qada and qadar. Surrender, not interfering, not complaining, not trying to change it or control it and have it be shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to decide what to know. And inshaAllah, tawfiq in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. في الدنيا والآخرة آمين. الحمد لله رب العالمين محمد الحبيب محمد الفاتح.
Manusia begitu senang untuk menghitung uang mereka yang masuk pada hari ini. Namun mereka melupakan rezeki sebenarnya adalah rezeki akhirat nanti. Apa yang sudah engkau berikan pada akhirat, apa yang kau temukan nanti pada alam kuburmu, apa yang sudah kita lakukan, kumpulkan sehingga kita mendapatkan harta sebenarnya nanti kelak di akhirat. Kita mesti memahami konsep pahala, ganjaran atau hasanat yang dimaksud, yakni sebenar-benarnya amal-amal soleh ini yang akan menyertai kita dalam kehidupan kita di akhirat kelak. Maka kita hitung bukan hanya uang yang masuk secara fisik, secara materi atau duniawi, namun amal kita, amal-amal mulia, berapa banyak musuh yang telah engkau maafkan pada hari ini, berapa banyak sedekah yang telah engkau berikan, berapa banyak solat nawafil yang telah engkau lakukan, berapa banyak hadiah atau sedekah yang engkau berikan, begitu pula berapa banyak ibadah-ibadah yang telah engkau lakukan. Ini semua semestinya menjadi perhatian kita dengan sungguh-sungguh. Ini semua adalah amal-amal yang akan memberikan kebahagiaan bagi kita di akhirat kelak. Zikir la ilaha illallah hingga tersenyum kepada saudara kita sesama muslim adalah harta yang terutama. Maka tanamlah pohonmu. Suhbah ini berbicara tentang rezeki sebenar-benarnya. Maka pahamilah agama Islam ini, qada dan qadar, lalu berserah dirilah kepada Allah. Semoga kita semua mendapatkan taufik kesuksesan di dunia ini maupun di akhirat kelak.
Many people, they come and they say, ya Sheikh, we need children. We need children. We don't have children. Many years passed, we don't have children. What we have to do? You teach them one ayah, or one hadith, or one message that Quran is sending to us, and after some time they recited as we all tell them, and after that time you will find them coming to you and say, we have children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala biyadihi al-khayr. Allah in his hands is the khayr, is the goodness. يُعِزُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيُذِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. He will put someone up, he put someone down. What you can do? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put you in a plane and say, drive it, you will try, but you cannot take off until Allah has come to order you, run it by Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. It is the way that Muslims open their doors through Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. That's one of the major rizq that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to humanity. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim.
Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina. So, you see, it all leads to Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, which is the summary of Surah Al-Fatiha, which is the summary of the Quran, which contains all of the heavenly books, Torah and Injil and Zabur and Suhuf of Sayyidina Ibrahim and all the prophets. It goes back to that. If an example, practical example, like a couple that does not have children and have been trying, like we just saw the other yesterday. And after a number of years, and they are reciting, and they have hope and sabr, but they keep their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They recite zikr, and they do their wazim, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts someone in a plane right now, and tells them, okay, you drive the plane, you fly the plane, oh, they cannot, they are not ready. When they are ready, they will fly. But it's a process, it's not something that, you know, you can decide for yourself. And in the end, you will, inshallah, you will be safe with the zikr, because zikr gives us all that we need to have at least nourishment for our souls until the time that we are complete fulfillment. But it is not right now. Right now it is a time of testing and patience. It's a time of work and dunya disappointment, but fulfillment of akhirah. If you see the side of the fulfillment of akhirah right now in dunya, that is the best way to the best state, inshallah. Because you are keeping your eyes on the prize of akhirah, and everything becomes like a small little kitten. It's not going to bother you. A little kitten. Even if it is disappointing right now, inshallah, in akhirah, it will be fulfilling and full of happiness.
Allahumma ajirna minan nar ya aziz ya ghaffar. Nah.
Ini semua berhubungan dengan basmalah, dengan bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Kesimpulan daripada surat Al-Fatihah pun juga berbicara tentang bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Begitu juga kesimpulan daripada kitab-kitab yang sebelumnya berbicara dengan hal yang sama. Maka beliau Maulana Syekh Hisham mengingatkan, seperti halnya kita hanya bisa memegang kemudi kita, namun pesawat itu akan tinggal landas bukan karena kita, tapi karena Allah Subhanahu wa taala. Kamu hanya bisa menaikinya dan memegangnya, tapi Allah yang memberikan perintah agar itu bisa berjalan, bisa terbang dan melayang. Hanya Allah yang menjalankan ini semua. Allah yang memberikan ini semua. Maka ingat, kita diminta untuk berzikir, dan zikir ini adalah proses. Bukan serta-merta semuanya terjadi. Semuanya memiliki proses untuk bisa sampai.
That example of the plane, that example of the plane that he said, put you in the plane and tell you fly. It is as if the person who is coming to the wali and saying, please give me, pray for Allah to give me that now. It's as if they are acting as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making them in charge of having the power to say to something, kun fayakun. But are they ready for that? If we say that the wali has that, because Sayyidina Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani said, I will make you Rabbani if you obey me, Allah said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, until you say to a thing, kun fayakun. But do they use it for changing the qada and qadar? They never use it for that. That is the difference between the wali whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam signed off on their process, and those who come unprepared. They will be like someone driving a plane not knowing how to drive it. What happens? Disaster. Awliya Allah don't want that. So they will not respond like that, but they will not make people despair. They never make people despair. So they keep us busy with hope in Allah, trust in Allah, zikr of Allah, remembrance of Allah, istighfar of Allah, return and tawbah to Allah. All of the things for which we are really responsible for. Because Allah who created us, He creates our children also. He is giving us everything that He created us for. We don't know better than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when and how many, etc. of all of our risks, including children. And same with knowledge also. No one of us say, Ya Rabbi, Ya Allah, make me now graduate. Before I do my 3-4 years of university, make me now professor. Before I do, make me now doctor. Before without medical school, you do that? No. Make me now a pilot of the plane without any study. This is not the sunnah of Allah on earth. It's the same thing. They are observing the sunnah of Allah on earth with reason. Allah teach us that understanding. And not leave us to ourselves and make awliya Allah as in something which is not from Islam, and not to make ourselves yani a shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concerning our destiny. It is in the hand of Allah, not ours. We did not create ourselves. We are not Maliki Yawm al-Din also, and we leave it to Rabbul Alamin. We leave it to Allah. Wa min Allah al-Tawfiq.
Perumpamaan tentang pesawat terbang tadi mengingatkan kita juga terhadap bagaimana seorang wali itu, ketika seseorang datang kepada seorang wali dan menginginkan untuk diberikan keturunan, maka sebenarnya memberikan keturunan itu bukan daripada wali itu, namun daripada Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah yang menetapkannya dari sana. Seperti halnya Syekh Abdul Qadir Al-Jilani dikatakan sebagai seorang Rabbani, karena dia mentaati dan memahami tentang kun fayakun, terjadi maka terjadi. Maka kita ini semua diminta untuk menyibukkan diri kita masing-masing dengan zikir, dengan mengingat Allah, dengan istighfar, memohon ampun, dengan taubat kembali kepada Allah. Bahwa Allah yang telah menciptakan kita, maka Allah pula yang akan mengaruniakan ciptaan lainnya seperti keturunan bagi kita. Maka kita berharap kepada Allah agar Allah memberikan pemahaman kepada kita untuk memahami tentang rezeki ini. Maka kita serahkan kesemuaan ini kepada Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Wa minallahi taufik, dan dari Allah itu sebuah kesuksesan.
Hormatil Fatihah.
Wal hormatil Fatihah.